Thank you for having me. It's a pleasure to be here. And what I'm going to talk about tonight will closely parallel the exhibit downstairs. So if you've had a chance to see that, I hope you'll see some connections. And if you haven't, then I encourage you to do that. And I want to most closely parallel it by emphasizing one of the primary constructs in art therapy, which is telling our own stories and how therapeutic and healing that can be, especially in a nonverbal symbolic way. So my clinical work has focused on, and I'm going to move around, and I found this afternoon that kind of standing there helped, so I'll be able to still make contact with you and point the laser at the screen and everything. My clinical work has focused on using art therapy with children and families after a disaster, a natural disaster or a human-created disaster, and certainly the war from which the children's drawings come from downstairs is an example of that, but this is true in wars since then, and certainly in the aftermath of a natural disaster like a tornado or an earthquake or a hurricane or a tsunami. And so I'm going to share some of my work internationally in that capacity, and also use children's drawings to help tell the stories of those children in the aftermath of those disasters. This is one of my favorite drawings that came out of Thailand after the tsunami that was caused by the Andaman-Sumatra earthquake in the Indian island. And this was drawn by a 9-year-old boy who had experienced the earthquake and was telling me his story. And often that's the prompt that I'll use, is tell me your story. Especially when I work with kids with disabilities, I don't want to plant something scary with them by saying, tell me where you were on 9/11, or tell me what you saw on 9/11, or tell me what happened, what was fearful. I'll just say, tell me your story. And so this young man drew a picture that I think even non-art therapists can see symbols in that are revealing of his experience after the tsunami. So you can see that those houses, strong houses, clearly drawn, and drawn in a way that children all over the world draw houses, but they're not connected to the land very securely, are they? They're kind of floating up there, which gave me a lot of information about how maybe he was feeling his own home might not be so securely attached to the land as well. I learned that children in the Andaman Islands are really skilled at drawing boats because it's right there in the middle of the Indian Ocean. The Indian Navy is based there, so they see boats all the time. So I saw lots of beautiful drawings of boats, and the kids were quite good at them. And lots of drawings of elephants, which is something that I don't see in my domestic work here in the United States. But tickles me no end. And you can see there's an elephant in this drawing. And I invite you to kind of think about what the story might be here with the elephant. Does anybody have any ideas what that elephant might be doing in this image? This is clearly after. The water has receded. There's logs down, there's trees bent. Absolutely. The elephants were used to move the large pieces of tree trunk after they'd been cut down. So they were cut into manageable pieces, and I say manageable, but I mean for an elephant. And the elephants were helping with the process of cleanup. And so he's telling the story of the aftermath. And one of the things that's really important in this story is he's able to tell that story. And I'll talk about in a little bit that sometimes it's even more difficult for children. Children who are exhibiting symptoms of post-traumatic stress may not be able to clearly articulate through an image what they've experienced. So through this lens of using images to tell one story, we can use those images to master traumatic experiences. I've learned, children have taught me, that anytime I'm working after a natural or human-created disaster, it's really important to provide materials that they can create buildings and structures. But not only the materials, like pieces of wood, or in this case, popsicle sticks, but materials to bind them together, because children will glue and wire and tape and hold those buildings together very strongly. And that's their way of making sure that they can hold their own homes together after a natural disaster. So that last image, this is actually from children created these in Manhattan, Kansas, after a tornado had touched down there. And so I use the same kind of technique of providing building materials and materials to hold them together in lots of different places after disasters. And this is from Haiti after the earthquake there. And I mentioned this afternoon that I wish I had photographed it before the glue had dried, because Elmer's glue dries clear, because there's a lot of glue in both of these. So they're really strongly held together. And that's the children's way of being able to master that idea of holding together buildings in their environment. We used found objects and aluminum foil to create figures that represented adults in their lives who had been helpful in the aftermath of the earthquake in Haiti. And so here a little boy is holding a figure that he's made and a figure that the girl working next to him had made. And after they made these figures of helpful adults, many of them play acted the interaction of the adults with the people who were living in the emergency camps. And so he's created this fella, and he said he was a footballer, which is a soccer player. And much like football heroes and baseball heroes here, these athletes are really admired and looked up to by young people in Haiti. And in this case, those athletes had actually been some of the ones who had provided clean water in those emergency camps. They had helped deliver it and circulate it. And so this little plastic bag here is what we all drank water out of after the earthquake and the landslides, the mudslides. And it was a vacuum-sealed plastic bag, kind of like a plastic bag version of a the juice drinks. So you would either bite the corner off or poke a little straw in and drink the water. So here he's got his little figure giving water to the other little figure. So he's acting out this helping relationship and mastering that idea that there are helping others. Importantly in art therapy, the art, the process of making and the actual imagery gives us literally and figuratively opportunities to contain powerful emotions. And we can provide containers for people to do that. And if we don't, then our artists will do that. And I need to point out that I often say children, but art therapy really is applicable with adults as well. The work that I've done internationally is primarily with children and families, so I often slip back to children, but it's really effective with people of all ages, and different materials apply to different people and are attractive to different kinds of people. So here are some examples of those containers. This is before medical procedures. There was no directive, it was just mandalas, which is any kind of artwork in a round circle. So I just gave round pieces of paper and art materials to the kids who were going to experience a medical procedure. And didn't ask them to tell me their story, they just did so quite spontaneously. And I hadn't provided any kind of boundary other than the edge of the paper. So you can see that they did this on their own. They held in that emotional content. And this little fella actually told me exactly what he was worried about, right, in the image. They're going to poke a hole in me. Mom's told me a needle's going in there. Isn't the blood coming out? Like, am I going to bleed? Is this going to be painful? So I was able to act as a kind of mediator with accurate information to say, yeah, the needle does go in, and there could be a little blood, but really there won't be much blood coming out, and by the time you count to 10, there really won't be pain associated with it either. And this little drawing, it's a house. Can you see the little chimney and the puffs of smoke? But it looks a little like a skull too, doesn't it? So I think that she really needed that container to hold in this fear that she had of the medical procedure as well. So those were examples of when I didn't provide containers for those emotions. But we can also do that quite purposefully in art therapy. So here's some examples of that. This is literally a container. It's a message in a bottle. And we decorated the bottle and put messages on the inside. And this was with high school students. And they were writing letters to someone. Someone they'd met or hadn't met, their future selves, their past selves, a god they believed in, a family member, someone who had passed, anyone that they wanted to, they could put a message in this bottle, and it was a container for that emotional content. The image here on the right came from a grief camp that we did in Emporia for kids who experienced the death of a loved one. And because I did this in partnership with a hospice organization, we all anticipated that the people who might participate, the children and families, might have experienced that death through a disease process or accident. But in fact, the participants had also experienced the death of a loved one through suicide and homicide. So it was a great learning experience for us to be really prepared for the grief that might come from anything. And so we provided these containers in the form of a line that went around and purposefully left it open in case any of that emotional content needed to come out. And the important thing, I've used t-shirts quite a lot in therapy, and it's a really great metaphor for providing boundaries with other people too. Because on the anniversary of a death, for example, it can be particularly painful to re-experience that, to have memories come flooding back. And we might want to be thinking about that person and celebrating their life on that day, but maybe we don't want to be asked about it. So if you wear a t-shirt like this because you're feeling that person close, maybe you put it under your jacket or your hoodie and it's close to you, but it's not public. But maybe you want to talk about that person. So you could wear the t-shirt and kind of advertise to others, today, this is important to me and this is what I need to communicate to you. We can think about tattoos that way too, right? So what many tattoos are memorials. Where do we put them? Do we put them where people can see them? Do we put them where only intimate people can see them? Do we hide them? Are they only for us to see? So this is similar to that without making a permanent mark on the body, huh? Okay, and this is something that I see often as a container for people who have experienced trauma as well. And this is not a clinical term, organizational caterpillars. It's one that I came up with because I see it so often in my work internationally. Children and adults will draw a border and then very precisely fill it in, almost like stained glass. And here's two examples. And I picked examples that were successful and also that were much more difficult. So the person on the left is more successfully kind of containing and organizing that psychological material, where the one on the right is struggling a little bit to do that. If I see that this is something that individuals are using as a coping mechanism, I'll actually provide things like graph paper so that they can fill in the little squares. It's not a creative process, but it's a repetitive, rhythmic process that's really therapeutic. Telling stories can actually help us to recenter, reframe, and problem solve as well. And I'll give you some examples of that. So this is these are from that same series of drawings by kids who are going to have minor medical procedures. And here's an example of a child doing a before and after drawing quite spontaneously. I didn't instruct her to do that. On the front of the paper, she's drawn herself having a needle, having an immunization. So this is the little girl, and this is her nurse giving it to her. And she's provided a boundary for herself and then another boundary for herself. And then the immunizations that the children were getting required that they stay in the presence of the physicians for some time after to make sure there was no reaction to it. So often the kids would come with little tears or kind of holding their breath right back to me to make more art so that they could kind of hold on to all this emotion that was happening. And so she came right back out, laid down on my little mat on the floor, and drew another picture on the back of hers. And often therapists will see themselves in the images that the kids create. And at the time that I did this, my hair was quite long. And so when I see really long hair like this, it's an indicator that it could be me. And in fact, she did say, "I'm back with you," and drew that long hair. With older kids, sometimes I'll see the little mark that I have on my cheek. They'll draw that as well. So I think that's a really strong indicator that there's an attachment happening there. And in lots of therapeutic relationships, that gives a lot of positive information to the therapist. And here's a wonderful example of something that we adults do all the time, right? When something's a little bit overwhelming, we go to our happy place. And so this little girl took herself right to her happy place. She was wearing a little green jumper and little black and green flowered leggings. And her happy place was, can you tell where she is? She's jumping on a trampoline in her backyard. There's her house. There's the clouds, there's the trampoline. She's just transported herself right to a place that has nothing to do with medical procedures or fear of bleeding or pain or any of those things. Quite spontaneous and a wonderful coping mechanism. Have any of you ever just in your mind gone to your happy place when you're stressed out?
Yeah. It's a high place. She took herself out.
Yeah. My place is the beach. I imagine the sound of the waves and the feel of the water. And for her, it was the trampoline. This is another image from the Andaman Islands, and I love this one because of its problem solving. This young man was the child of, I believe, someone who served on one of the Navy vessels, and he's given us a drawing of one of the ships from the front. So this wasn't what I would think of as the drawing of the boat, but if you're familiar enough with boats, they actually can look this way from the front. And so on the boat is a tree, because if you're going to be out at sea for a long time, you put things on the ship that make you feel not so far out at sea, right? And he's drawn the national flag. And he understood that the fishermen and the Navy folks who were out at sea really didn't feel the impact of the tsunami. When they're out at sea, a ship or a boat rises and comes back down, but a tsunami doesn't become a wall of water, a wave, until it hits shallow water. So folks who were out at sea didn't necessarily even know what was happening until they came back. And what this little guy has done, because he wasn't worried about the ship, is he's anchored the land down. He's held it in place. A really wonderful abstract problem solving where he's secured that land to make it safe. Part of the beauty of art therapy is that it is a nonverbal process, largely. We do talk as well. It does make it a bit easier for my work internationally because if I don't speak the language, there isn't quite the same necessity for translation. It is important to have that because you don't want to misunderstand. But often you can cross expansive bridges with the imagery itself. We have to remember that symbols can be universal, so that if we all see a drawing of a heart, it probably means the same thing, as an example. Although it could also be a very personal symbol, a drawing of a heart could mean something different to me than it does to you. And symbols can also be culturally specific. So there are three kind of different layers of symbol making, and as art therapists, we have to be constantly aware of them so that we're not interpreting people's art. The artist is the one who understands what the symbol means. These images were drawn by children who were having more direct symptoms that were indicative of post-traumatic stress after the tsunami. And these drawings were done by kids who, before the tsunami, were drawing more age-appropriate images. And one of the things that happens when we experience trauma is that there can be regression. So behaviorally, an example of this might be an 8-year-old who had not experienced a trauma and then experienced something very scary or life-changing and begins to wet the bed. So there's a regression in behavior. But we also see this in the artwork. So a child who's gone well beyond scribbling as a developmental stage in their artwork might return to kind of this scribbling and also kind of this kind of inability to organize thoughts, which happens after a traumatic experience. You can see that they've, because I was speaking English and these children didn't speak English, they were showing me that I know a little bit of your language. They're giving me letters, right? So they're telling me, I can identify with you. I want to tell you about me and how we're similar. And I can see houses in here, but they're not organized the way that they had been prior to the experience. And these are done by children who had who were having even more symptomology of post-traumatic stress, behavioral issues, problems sleeping, nightmares, problems eating. And we can see that the artwork paralleled those symptoms. I had only moved to Kansas, I guess it was in 2005, and just a couple years after that, there had been a tornado that touched down in Manhattan. And a graduate of the program that I direct, who had gone through the program before I moved to Kansas, called me from Manhattan and she said, my daughter drew this. And we had talked about the tornado, our house was only damaged a little bit. I thought everything was fine, and then I saw this drawing. So it's a drawing of a tree, but it looks a lot like a tornado. So as a mom, she said, I think that we need to do programming in Manhattan. If my daughter's having this trouble, there's other children too. So we set up a program for the whole summer, and once a week we would have an open studio night where children and families could come and make art, and the two of us as art therapists were there to facilitate the programming. And the art also allows us to connect with each other. And I think that the exhibit downstairs does this, connects us to history in a really important way. That if you're members of the museum and you understand the World War, the war to end all wars, and you go downstairs and you look at the exhibit, you can read those stories relatively effectively without being an art educator or a developmental psychologist or an art therapist. You understand part of that story. And art connects us in lots of ways like that. And as I'm talking, in a minute we're going to switch to you guys making art. So as we talk about these last slides, I encourage you to kind of think about symbols that may come to you in terms of the idea of a museum and memorial. So if museums and memorials like this one are to help us remember people or significant ideas or wisdom that we can carry with us, what are those symbols and how do we incorporate those in who we are, either on a personal or culturally or universal level? So I'm going to continue here. This is also from Haiti. I think this was my first trip to Haiti. I made 4 after the earthquake. And I think that if I had lots of funding to do almost any research I wanted to do as a university professor, one of the things I would really love to look at is the role of altruistic behavior in our own healing processes. So if you've ever had a blue day, and even if you've not experienced clinical depression, and you may have, but if you've just had a really difficult time, sometimes one of the best things that you can do is do something for someone else. I think that there's such a connection there that I'd love to look at from a research context. And so we gave that opportunity to the children who were attending a hospice program in Haiti, and they worked in pairs or in groups of three to decorate t-shirts that were then distributed to people in the community who needed assistance or clothing. So in the poorest nation in the Western Hemisphere, we were giving them this power to give to the community. And you can think of ways where you've been affected by grief or someone you love has. Maybe the impulse is to fill a widower's freezer with casseroles. Or maybe it's to put flowers and candles on the place where someone has passed in an accident or disaster. And I think that this is a part of the human condition and one of the ways that we react. And I think art and symbology is a really important part of making that process available. Now, anytime I do art with kids where they're giving something away, and often, in fact, with adults who are going to give something away, there's an opportunity for them to do something that they keep as well. So these were pre-printed mandalas, but we also had an opportunity for the kids to make their own t-shirts. And the t-shirts that they created had symbols of the strength and the support that they received after the earthquake. So people who supported them, things that were helpful to them, faith systems that helped them through that time. And they could wear those on themselves as protection. We actually did this with the medical doctors in a hospital on a different trip, and the doctors and nurses made t-shirts with the symbols of strength that they brought into the medical profession. Why did they become a doctor? Why did they become a nurse? If you can imagine the turnover in medical profession here in the United States, imagine that in the aftermath of a natural disaster where so many people have died. The stress level on the caretakers is incredible. So they made t-shirts with the strengths that they brought into their work, the love that they had for their countrymen, the intelligence or the faith or any of the interests that brought them to that field. And then they wore them underneath their scrubs. These are some of my students last year. You may recall that I think it was last November, the FBI intercepted communication that let them know that a mosque in Western Kansas, there was a plan to bomb a mosque. And although the three men who had initiated these plans were captured before anything happened, it was devastating for the community to know that there was this kind of hate aimed at them. So my students on fabric created messages of peace and unity and stitched them together on a ribbon, which is really reflects kind of the Tibetan prayer flags and their messages of peace and hope, and then they delivered them to the leaders of that faith community in that part of the state. And these are examples of ways that I've used hands in two different parts of the world in terms of reaching out. And you can think of all the ways we use hands in our language, giving a hand, a helping hand, a hand up, a hand out, helping someone. And so hands are really wonderful symbols for community connection. And the ones on top were created. My husband and I lived in Australia for a year. And at that time, there were really incredible reconciliation efforts going on in terms of land ownership from the original owners of the land and the colonialists who had moved into that land. And at the bottom, this is after Hurricane Katrina on the Gulf Coast of the United States. And there was so much goodwill and wanting to reach out, in part because the needs had not been met for the community. And when that had been recognized, people would actually come from other parts of the country to reach out and help in ways that they can. So a couple other examples. So I put these on here. Do you have any questions so far of what we've talked about? Any thoughts?
Do you do sand tray work?
I don't personally do a lot of sand tray work. I have been minimally trained in it, and I am very familiar with it. And a lot of the kind of constructs of Jungian art therapy are very similar to sand tray work.
It's interesting, and I've done sand tray work with children, and what you showed in your mandala around the perimeter, the most stressed children will often use beads or coins to make the perimeter boundary first before they will put anything in the center portion.
Absolutely, they've got to reaffirm that boundary. Are you familiar with sand tray? So in a sand tray, it's a therapeutic technique that's used. It's very Jungian in its philosophy. And you actually, instead of like on a canvas or piece of paper, you're working with, usually made out of wood, not always, a tray that's painted blue at the bottom and then has 3 or 4 inches of white sand in it. And sand tray therapists will have shelves and shelves of symbols, superheroes, animals, clocks, houses, lots and lots of things that you can then incorporate into making a scene or an image into the sand tray. And you can dig things down and bury them. You can expose the blue on the bottom almost like a water source. And it's a way very similar to art therapy, working non-verbally and symbolically.